It was now 8 a.m. local time on May 8, 1908, and in 5 seconds the true deadliest day in the entire history of Martinique would begin. As building pressure underneath the Mount Pelee volcano's summit had begun breaking overlying rock and was about to reach the surface. Within only a few minutes, the most prosperous town in the entire Caribbean, Saint-Pierre, which at the time held 28,000 residents and internal refugees, would be reduced to ashes with only a handful of survivors. Before I discuss what exactly happened on that fateful day, there are three characters I would like to introduce that are crucial to this story. The first person in question is Ludger Silberus, age 28 at the time. 6 days prior, on May 2nd, he had engaged in a barroom brawl assaulting another man. As a result, he was jailed for assault for 1 month in the Saint-Pierre prison, and due to bad behavior, he was placed in solitary confinement on May 7th. The location he was placed in was crucial, as the room had no windows or easy access ventilation to the surface, meaning that fresh air did not easily make its way to his cell. The solitary confinement room was also well built, surrounded by a very thick layer of stone. Little did he know that day that being placed in solitary confinement would actually save his life, becoming the most famous survivor of the catastrophe that was about to unfold. The second individual of note was Leon Compère Leandre, age 28, who was a longtime shoemaker. After waking up on May 8th, he went outside to relax by standing in the street just outside his front door. Our third person of interest was a young girl, age 10, who went by the name Havivra de Ifril. Despite her young age, she was strong, having frequently used a rowboat in her spare time. All three of these individuals would end up surviving the eruption. Yet, while 67 survived the eruption, 28,000 people would not. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. All of a sudden, the building pressure underneath Pelee's summit dome broke through the last stretch of the overlying lava dome that had formed, destroying much of it and generating a tremendous explosion. As a plume of ash began rising into the atmosphere, much of this plume was too heavy to rise on the buoyant column of hot air, causing it to rapidly collapse back to the ground to form a series of towering superheated pyroclastic flows. As a quick reference, pyroclastic flows are a fast-moving current of hot gas and volcanic matter that flows along the ground away from a volcanic vent at speeds often exceeding 100, sometimes 200 kilometers per hour. These flows burn and incinerate everything organic they touch and contain a mixture of scorching hot lava, hard rock, ash, deadly superheated volcanic gases, and regular air. Since these mostly ground-hugging or near-ground pyroclastic flows carry with them numerous sand-to-house-sized rocks, they're absurdly dangerous. This is why among all world volcanoes, they're the number one direct rather than indirect killer, with volcanic tsunamis falling in second place. Pyroclastic flows were the main cause of deaths in famous eruptions such as Vesuvius in 79 CE, Leamington in 1951, and of course Pelee in 1902. While the initial pyroclastic flows spread out in all directions at a speed of 130.5 miles per hour or 210 kilometers per hour, the summit crater, now both open and descending to the southwest and south-southwest, would cause the vast majority of the pyroclastic flow material to carry on motion solely in that direction. It took 10 seconds for these incandescent walls of death to surpass the area damaged by the volcano's 1792 eruption, 17 seconds to travel a full kilometer, and 27 seconds for the larger area damaged by the 1851-1852 eruption to be reached. At 28 seconds in, the pyroclastic flow had traveled a full mile. Simultaneously, the rising eruption column, now filled with abundant volcanic lightning flashes, continued to rise, and would later on expand outwards in the shape of a mushroom plume, rising to reach an elevation of at least 12 kilometers or 39,400 feet. Back on the ground, the young girl, Havivra de Ifril, looked at the mountain and just knew that something was terribly wrong. While chaos unfolded around her, and as she continued to feel the intense heat further increase as the seconds progressed, she made her way to a small rowboat. As fast as she could, Haviva then began rowing away from Saint-Pierre to hide in a nearby sea cave. Around 30 to 40 seconds in, the pyroclastic flows from the initial collapsing eruption column at the north, northeast, and east of the mountain ceased their forward progress, while with deadly force two lobes of pyroclastic flows continued to the southwest. All vegetation was incinerated in their path, and many trees were blown down in the direction the superheated gas current headed, stripped of all visible greenery. Now, at 1 minute 10 seconds in, the pyroclastic flow passed by the village of Mornay Rouge without destroying it due to the settlement being partially protected on a high ridge above the 25,000-year-old collapse scar. 21 seconds later, the first lobe of the pyroclastic flow reached the shoreline and then did something terrifying. It entered the ocean and continued expanding outwards on top of the Atlantic Ocean, albeit at a decreased velocity of 34.1 miles per hour or 54.9 kilometers per hour. Since this displaced nearby ocean water, it generated a small 1-meter-high tsunami. By this point, marking 91 seconds in, the pyroclastic flow had already traveled 5.3 kilometers or 3.3 miles and showed no signs of stopping. And a mere 1 second later, the first certain fatalities occurred of the day as the most outlying series of structures were impacted, burned, and bulldozed in the time span of only a few seconds. As the day seemingly turned to night, hot embers were carried ahead of the plume and people rightfully panicked. In the harbor, the captain of the Diamond ordered his crew of 40 to overcharge the steam engines, bringing them well beyond its designed limit to get out of the advancing death cloud as fast as they could. Structures on the northern shoreline were quickly obliterated, and then 103 seconds in, the edge of Saint-Pierre was reached. The center of town was obliterated a mere 16 seconds later, striking the prison that held Ludger's Silberus. This jail was not originally a jail, but meant to hold gunpowder stores and thus withstand naval bombing. There, in the essentially unvented and windowless room, he felt an absurdly intense heat. While the heat to everything outside of this room likely reached 400 to 600 degrees Celsius, the solitary room offered a level of protection, with only some gas reaching into the cell with a lesser temperature of around 90 degrees Celsius. This immediately caused severe second and third degree burns to much of his body. While his inner cell would survive, the rest of the prison collapsed all around him. At the same time, the shoemaker Leon Compere Leandre came off far worse. While I have been unable to locate where exactly he lived, descriptions placed him at the edge of Saint-Pierre, where he was presumably partially protected from the most severe portion of the pyroclastic flow. He noted that once the light vanished from the sky, he went inside, where all of a sudden everyone felt immense pain. Clothing did not ignite, but the skin burned. It is uncertain how long the intense heat lasted for, but Leon himself suggests around 10 minutes. During this time span, every structure in Saint-Pierre was destroyed and 28,000 lives were lost. Several hundred of these deaths at a minimum occurred across at least 300 smaller ships and 17 larger ships in the harbor. The deadly pyroclastic flow had traveled up to 4.3 kilometers into the ocean, claiming so many victims. Yet, because the pyroclastic density currents that struck the ocean and ships were more dilute, it also created the potential for some survivors there. Let us quickly discuss the fate of some of these ships. When we last saw the Diamante, it had put its boilers well past their design limit in an attempt to escape the fate that awaited so many surrounding ships. However, before the pyroclastic flow struck the ship, the overworked boiler exploded, immediately sinking the ship and killing 39, with only a single crew member thrown into the water who would later survive. At the largest ship in the harbor, the Roraima, with a mass of 2,700 tons and length of 104 meters, also had survivors, initially 20 of its original 68 crew. However, since the ship was carrying a substantial amount of potassium, its cargo would continue burning for 3 continuous days with a distinctive purple flame. The ship would eventually sink, and by the time 20 of its survivors had been rescued and sent to a safer town, only 11 were still alive. However, the most famous ship, which has almost become an urban legend of sorts, so it is tough to determine what is and isn't true, involves a cable ship known as the Grappler. After the deadly May 5th Lahar struck low pressure, it had been used to evacuate the town's remaining residents. People who lived there at the time were often exceptionally wealthy, and these people kept a lot of said wealth in gold bars. Well, it is rumored that when the Grappler was sunk by the eruption, losing all 53 hands aboard, that it still had that gold present. And yet, despite the location I have given the ship in my diagram, we actually have no clue where it sunk. We haven't found its wreckage to date, and allegedly there is still gold out there if someone was to find this ship. Quick late note, I want to remind everyone to not break the law and look for this ship because there is a supposed treasure which in my opinion is either outright unobtainable or doesn't even exist. Please don't search for this ship. I am merely telling the tale surrounding the Grappler and its alleged lost treasure because it's interesting to me. Yet, not every single major ship in the waters off Saint-Pierre sunk that day, as on the very outskirts of the Pyroclastic Flow, the ship Rodham had 18 of its 44 crew survive. Despite the raging inferno and fires that quickly spread around the ship, through a good and knowledgeable captain and the hard work of his crew, they were able to save the ship. Subsequently, the Rodham left for Fort de France. Everything north of the so-called Annihilation Line in the town, that being essentially marked by the Roxelin River, was completely obliterated, with only foundations remaining. To the south, every structure was still destroyed and their occupants deceased, but many still had walls still standing, indicating negligibly less severe damage. By the time the firestorm had ended, what had been a town with 28,000 people at the beginning of the day now only had what I estimate to be 27 survivors. Most of these survivors lived on the outskirts of the town or at high elevations, and thus received the least duration and heat when the pyroclastic flows struck. But let's look back at the three most famous survivors. Haviva de Ifril successfully escaped into a sea cave where, while in the boat, she would lose consciousness for a time, either due to the intense heat of the passing pyroclastic flow or due to asphyxia due to the displacement of oxygen. She would eventually wake up and be rescued by the French warship Suchet while drifting in a slightly burned boat 3 kilometers out to sea. As for Leon Compere-Leandre, while many of those around him with the same experience perished, he suddenly awoke an hour after passing out. His house was then on fire, and thankfully he managed to escape in time. He then, while injured and burnt, ran a full 5.7 kilometers to the unharmed village of Fon Saint-Denis. As for Ledger Silberus, he would be found on May 11th crying for help, hoping someone could hear him as he had not eaten and barely drank any water during the prior few days. Debris was cleared and then he was rescued, later telling his unique tale to reporters and scientists. All of the 15 other burning ships in the harbor struck by the pyroclastic flows would eventually sink, comprising a portion of the 69.3 square kilometers or 26.8 square miles incinerated by pyroclastic flows. Yet, while so much had been lost already, Pelee's eruption was not yet over, nor had it even claimed its last victims. As a final note, I would like to thank my new YouTube channel member, Mantolwin, for supporting my work. Support from people like you on YouTube and Patreon allows me to make these long-form deep dive videos.